So I think we're going to begin. It's 10:35, and today we're going to be talking about Israel. Good, Ruby just joined. Perfect. Hi, Ruby. Glad you're here too. There's so much to say about Israel. Such a big topic, and I was just for our class looking up a YouTube of Hatikva, and Hatikva is the national anthem of Israel. And as you were scrolling down all of the comments for Hatikva, it was people from all over the world saying, I love you from Pakistan, I love you from Saudi Arabia, I love you from Morocco. And it was like, not so much I love you, it was the other way around. But it's amazing how many emotions the story of our return to our homeland evokes, not just in us, but in throughout the whole world. And that this little country and the story of our return, whether it's part of what we decided or just what happened, has become, kind of like all eyes on us, right? There's a sense that the world, there are more journalists per capita in Israel than in any other country in the world. And in Jerusalem, more journalists per capita because there are so many stories. So there's so much to write about. And the story of our return is an unprecedented story, a grand story. There's a lot of, it's good to be in the attention of the world sometimes, not always. There's kind of been that tension within Zionism from the very beginning, which is Zionism supposed to make us like a country like every other country? Is that what the purpose of Zionism, of the Zionist movement, to turn Israel into a country for the Jews, just like Italy is for the Italians or the Greece for the Greeks? Or is there, at the same time, you have this other side, which is the spiritual religious component, which goes back thousands of years and which has purpose behind it, to be a light unto the nations, to be a kingdom of priests, and these high aspirations. And so there's this beautiful synergy between a this-worldly truth. The state of Israel was founded by regular people who lived in this world, and the spiritual yearning which led to it over long periods of time. I was thinking earlier this week, so when my daughter Shalva was born, and I remember I had this thought, she's my firstborn, and I think especially firstborns one has this thought, I thought, until you came into the world, I hadn't realized my life was not complete. But when you came into the world, I realized that you're perfect in every single way. And that even she's a human being like everyone else, but there's just something about it, the way it happened, I could have never imagined that this being coming into my life would have brought what it did. And I think that the founding of the state of Israel, the way it happened with all of the things around it, or the all the different parts, the cultural, the spiritual, even the difficulties, created a sense among Jews that the way it happened, not for everyone, but for many, that there was a divine hand that was part of it. Doesn't mean that the divine is putting its stamp of approval on everything that's ever happened, but it happened in such a larger than life way. It was kind of like watching the perfect movie that you could have never imagined play in front of you because of all the different aspects and how it came to be and how all the parts fit together to lead into the modern state. Something that was very old, but it doesn't feel old. Something that was this wonderful vibrancy and youth and a new side that came in, and the new and the old coexisting so synergetically and beautifully in Israel have created this amazing country, but also a very perplexing country because it's there's so many different things going on, and it's really complicated to pull out, okay, what is this worldly, what is otherworldly, or what is my religious sentiment, and what is just a political reality, and it's complex, but it's totally fascinating. So I think we'll begin. Does anybody have the pack with them, or would you like me to put up on the screen? Okay, I'll put up on the screen. That way you can see from the lesson plan that we have. Maybe another word before we begin. You know, I often teach, as I've mentioned before, Judaism to Hindus. It's just one of the things that I've done quite a bit of. And the way I always try and teach it to them is I say that Israel, that the Jewish people, first of all, are a mother religion like Hinduism. We gave birth to other religions. But I also talk that we have this attachment to land. And just like the Hindus, if anybody's ever been to India, they're like, you know, this is where this myth happened. This is where this myth happened. This is where this myth happened. And India is the land of their pilgrimage, the land of their, everything happened there. It's just their religion is intertwined with the land. It would be hard to imagine Hinduism, whatever Hinduism is, without the land. And somehow it's always been that way for us too. And you know, one way to imagine our return to the land when I talk to people is, you know, the Tibetans were exiled from Tibet. But imagine if the Tibetans spent 2,000 years outside of Tibet, but then by some miracle, they were able to go back to Tibet. What joy would come from that return to the land where they'd come from, the land of their development as a religion. Or the Navajos. Imagine if the Navajos have been exiled from the Navajo nation for so very long, but kept up their identity and finally be able to return to, I don't know how many of you have been to that stretch of Arizona and New Mexico, which is the area where Navajo is. So there's something about Israel. Israel is the land where the Bible happened, the land of our pilgrimage, the land of the where it all happened. On the other hand, it's also Jews have been out of the land more than they've been in the land throughout our history. So there's a way of not negating Jews who live outside of the land and of somehow balancing all of those different things. But there's a real power and beauty to it. And so let's begin. We're going to begin with an exercise to try and think about it, how we all relate to it, because we all have some relationship to it. And so we have people, land, and state. So these are three important components. Anybody want to say, what is the Jewish people? What does Am Yisrael mean to them? And we'll do the same for Eretz Yisrael, and how do you each relate to it? Anybody want to share a few words? No wrong answers. What are the Jewish people?
We're the Jewish people, all of us around the world, both in Israel and the diaspora. Mm-hmm.
And the Jewish people are, you know, the idea of peoplehood is so important to us as the Jewish people. You said the people twice, but the Jewish, you know, other religions are very universally minded. They're not based on a people, but our religion is based on a people very strongly, a people that one can join and be part of. But we're civilization, right? That's what Mordechai Kaplan said. That's the best way to describe Jewish peoplehood. We're a civilization, but we stretch the Jewish people, as Ed said, you know, it's, you know, anytime you can walk into a synagogue in India, or you can walk into a synagogue in Spain or in the US, and the service is not that different, and all the people are of different nationalities, are also part of some kind of people, a brotherhood and sisterhood stretching across the world. Anybody else have any thoughts about Am Yisrael? And, you know, our tradition looks at Am Yisrael really spiritually too. The Am Yisrael is also all the Jewish souls of all time and all the souls who will ever be part of the Jewish people, either born or joined later on in life, all part of that Jewish people. Then we have Eretz Yisrael, the land of Israel. So what's the land of Israel? Is it the land described in the Bible? I mean, what are the limits of a land of Israel? I mean, anybody have any thoughts?
Not really related to borders. I think it's more of a spiritual ideal than like the modern state. Like there's laws that apply within and outside the land of Israel. So it's a different concept in the state. Like it's on a more spiritual plane perhaps.
Beautiful. Yeah, it is definitely more spiritual, but it's also complicated because, so for example, this is where it becomes complicated. You know, there are Jewish laws that pertain specifically to agriculture in the land of Israel, right? So you're supposed to give a tenth, you know, when you're supposed to let the land lay fallow on the seventh year, you're supposed to give a tenth to this and a tenth for that. So you still need to have those actual borders to Eretz Yisrael just for halakhic purposes. So people had to decide, well, is it which is it the borders are described in the book of Joshua 3,000 years ago, or is it the borders described this? So there's a trouble in trying to describe something that essentially became very spiritualized over long periods of time. You were saying, Yochanan, after the temple was destroyed and Jews left Israel 2,000 years ago, that connection to land very much became spiritualized. It became the heavenly Jerusalem, the heavenly Israel. These are words that we use. It doesn't mean that the yearning was not for a real place. People also, Jews throughout the thousands of years, always returned to Israel and went there. But most people did not have that opportunity to go there. But there was always a sense of that interplay between, you know, the heavenly and the earthly. And a story that I wanted to mention connection to that is, before the modern wave of modern Zionism, which was a very disworldly, non-religious movement, there were in the early 1800s movement of Hasidim who moved back to Israel. The Hasidic movement in the late 1700s was a revival movement bringing spirituality back to Judaism. And there were some there who said, we've got to follow our ancient yearning for Zion. And there's a wonderful story of some Hasid who, you know, does it and brings his whole community over to the land of Israel in the 1800s, when Israel was a dusty kind of, nothing was going on there, a corner of the Ottoman Empire. And he comes there and he says, you know, I was expecting a city paved with gold and jewels everywhere, but I found this dusty city in Jerusalem. And but then the story goes, 10 years later, he said, he convened all of his friends and he had a big party. And he said, when I first came here, I was expecting to see cities, streets paved in gold and jewels. And I just found these forlorn hills. But this morning, for the first time, I woke up and I looked out my window and I realized the city, the hills really are made of gold if you but have the eyes to see them. And I think part of what that is saying is that there's a spiritual power to the land of Israel. That's how Jews have seen it. There's a spiritual power to it. And it's not always easy to see it because there's so many layers above, but you have moments, you know, people who go to Israel who are not religious and suddenly they're in front of the Western Wall for the first time, and it does something to them. They have a sense of the power. There's a power to that land and a connection to the Jewish soul, right? The Talmud says, you know, that the Jewish soul is aligned with the land. And so there's a sense of that land, whatever it is, the land is way beyond just the modern state and beyond any political entity, but that land has tremendous power. It gave birth to, right, Western religion. That land, you can't always see it, but if you can listen to it, maybe I'm being a little mystical and spiritual here, but if you have the eyes to see it, then you can see that beauty of the land. And you know, it is very powerful. You know, there's this whole, there's actually a unique syndrome called the Jerusalem syndrome, where Jews and Christians go to Jerusalem and lose their minds because they're like, wow, I'm on the land of David or Jesus. And there's a sanitarium outside of Jerusalem where they put people who have Jerusalem syndrome because they suddenly think, I'm Jesus, I'm David, I'm this, I'm that. And that part of the land. So then we have Medinat Yisrael, which is the state of Israel. Eretz Yisrael means the land of Israel. Medinat Yisrael means the land of Israel. Medina means the state. So the state, right? The state was created in 1948. You have different governments. The people who lead it are, you know, just like any other people. Anybody have any other thoughts on the state of Israel? So the state of Israel is a state like every other, we're growing and changing, and there've been endless poems and different things written about it from every side, because you have the phenomenon of us who don't live in Israel, who go to Israel and who love the land of Israel and who are taking pictures of the land of Israel. And the Israelis are like, hey, there are people who actually live on this land here, who do their groceries and who are, who are just living their regular lives. And you guys are like, move away. I want to take a picture of this arch from Roman times, right? That's what the poet Yehuda Amichai writes in one of his poems. It's just such a complex but interesting interweaving between the two. And as an Israeli, I was born in Israel. And there are times when I go to Medinat Yisrael, and not to comment on the political, but the culture is a very stressed culture at the moment. And sometimes I love it to bits, and sometimes it drives me crazy. And the land of Israel, on the other hand, is something that I feel so powerfully connected to. Because I feel it in my bones. I really feel it is the land of the Jewish people. Charles, go ahead.
Well, I was just saying, how do you distinguish then or separate between Eretz Israel and the Medina, the current state? I mean, it seems that there's a bit of a blur there. It's not a black and white distinction, or am I mistaken?
No, you're right. There's no black and white distinction, especially since, not everybody believes it, but I strongly feel that the return to the land had a spiritual component to it. So the Medina, the land of Israel, was born and is on essentially very similar lines to, though with many complications, to the land of Israel. And we're speaking our ancient language that we revived, right? The only time in the history of the world that an ancient language has been revived. There's a lot of similarities between the land of Israel and the ancient Israel and the new Israel. And you're right, they're totally connected. There's no way to separate them, but it's all one beautiful mess.
Okay, well, thank you.
Yeah, so we're gonna continue on. So before actually we go, I'd like to say, we've been talking about how that yearning for the land of Israel, once the exile began 2,000 years ago, was kept alive within the Jewish people. What are some ways that you can think of that Judaism kept alive that yearning for Israel, the land of Israel? Yochanan.
Three times a day, we say Bonei Yerushalayim in the Amidah. So who rebuilds Jerusalem?
Right, we pray in the Amidah, who rebuilds Jerusalem.
At the end of every Passover Seder, we say next year in Jerusalem.
Right, we say next year in Jerusalem. We pray, what direction do we pray in? We pray to the east, right? We pray to Jerusalem. We throughout our prayers, we have many mentions of Israel and the land of Israel throughout all of our prayers. My friend Yossi Klein Halevi, who's going to be coming later in the month to do a lecture on Israel, but he's part of this institute in Israel called the Hartman Institute, which they're kind of like the world leading think tank of Judaism in Jerusalem. And they have this program called the Muslim Leader Leadership Institute, where they bring American Muslims to Israel to teach them about Zionism, but not at all in a, this is, from a very kind of transparent way. And the Muslim leaders also go to the West Bank and Gaza and learn all about, it's a really kind of open dialogue. This is where we're coming from. It's very respectful. And their first lesson is always, chapter 12 of Genesis. God says to Abraham, go away from your land, right? Abraham lived in Babylonia, and says, go away from your father's house, from the land of your birth, and go to the land that I will show you, right? So from the very beginning of our religion, there's always been a land involved there, the land that I will show you. You know, they always say, Yossi says that whenever they teach that to the Muslims, who are very faithful, faith-based people, Muslims in general are very often have a very strong connection to scripture and belief in the people of the book. And they say, oh, I never realized that you Jews have a connection to the land going all the way back to Abraham. And that really opens the door for them to understand that that the creation of the state of Israel is not just a modern imposition, but that Jews have been yearning for the land for so very long. It's just part of who we are. So another way that we remember Israel is before every holiday and Shabbat and joyous event, blessing after meal, Birkat HaMazon, we say this psalm. Would somebody like to read for us the psalm, Psalm 126?
A song for ascending. When God restores the exiles of Zion, we will be like dreamers. Our mouths will fill with laughter and our tongues with joyful song. It will be said among the nations, God has done great things for them. God will do great things for us and we will have joy. Restore us, Adonai, like streams of water to the desert. The ones who sow in tears shall reap with songs of joy. Though he goes along weeping, carrying his bag of seed, he will come back with joy, carrying his sheaves.
Beautiful. Thank you. So, right, this psalm is one of the most read psalms in our liturgy. And one of the things that people comment about it, that it's kind of ambiguous. People aren't sure, it's hard to see in this translation, but it's hard, is it referring to the past? Because there was a first exile when the first temple was destroyed and Jews were sent out into exile to Babylonia, but then they returned. So is it referring to returning from then, or is it referring to the future? And there's we will be like dreamers is kind of the central statement of it. And it expresses that longing, that sense of dreaming, right? That dream for Zion has always been part of there, that our mouths will be filled with laughter and our tongues of joyful song. And right, why? One of the reasons we break a glass at a wedding is because our mouths are not totally filled with laughter and our tongues are not totally filled with joyful song until God restores until we're back in Zion. But we are back in Zion, but wait, are we back? There's almost like a sense that returning to Zion is almost like the end of times. It's when peace will come, not only when we're back living in Zion, but also when peace is there. And so it's like, I remember once being in a class at the Hartman Institute I was talking about, and we were talking about, well, what do you do if you've had a dream for 2,000 years and then that dream actually comes to reality? What do you do? And so we said, you have to find a new dream. So, you know, to some degree, we've been dreaming for 2,000 years of being back in Israel. And on some level, that dream has been fulfilled. You know, I mean, what do you say when you're when you come to the end of the Seder in Jerusalem? What do you say? You don't say next year in Jerusalem because you are in Jerusalem. So that doesn't make no sense. So you say—
if you want to continue to be in Jerusalem.
Okay, so you could say you could continue to be in Jerusalem, but it doesn't have that aspiration of, I'm not there now. So what they say is, they say next year in Jerusalem, Habnuya, Yerushalayim Habnuya, in the built up Jerusalem. That means the Jerusalem has been built up. But a lot of people say, well, I look at Jerusalem now, it's this beautiful city, it's been built up. So what do I say now? So, you know, there's a sense of our dreams having being fulfilled. We're living in it. Though one thing that I to mention is that even though our dreams were fulfilled, so often in this broken world that we live in, it happened right after the worst disaster that ever happened to the Jewish people, right? The Holocaust. And so some of our joy of returning to the land was dampened by that tragedy, right? It didn't, you know, I don't want to make any comparisons, but it's like a birth after some horrible death, or, you know, we birthed our dream, but what it took for us to have it was indescribable. And the sacrifice was horrendous. We're still living within this psalm, right? We will be like dreamers. Our mouths will fill with laughter, our tongues with joyful song. On the other hand, we were there. Are we there? Or are we still yearning for it. It's kind of, it's the part of the, you know, the spiritual Jerusalem we're all still trying to bring onto earth, a Jerusalem of peace, a Jerusalem of harmony. And yet we're living in times that are, that Jews for thousands of years would have done anything to live in. Anybody have any thoughts on Psalm 126? Okay, let's continue. So if you look at this line, this is another psalm we sing. If I forget you, Jerusalem, let me forget my right hand, right? People said that for thousands of years. So that was, you know, people would have given their right hand to be able to go to Israel and live in Israel, in Israel where they with sovereignty, with and at the, you know, when they often talk to young people about Israel, and I'm bringing a lot of different elements here to this discussion, but right, what we live in a very universalistic age, right? People want to think of life from a universal lens, but our story of connection to Israel is a very particularistic story, right? It's a story of when people returning to their land. And it's hard for a lot of young people to connect to that because we live in a universal age. On the other hand, the way, you know, the sentiment, if I forget you, Jerusalem, let me forget my right hand. Young people, you know, connect to it, but it's not as important often as the universal aspect of that we're all human beings living in one world. But the way I love to phrase it is that, you know, our particularistic lens as a Jewish people, our story, our connection to land, to a certain history, that gives us a window into our universalism that's a lot deeper and more powerful. It's the gateway to our universal aspect as human beings. We're coming to our universality from that particularistic story. So here is the Jewish state's national anthem. Would someone like to read it for us in the English?
As long as deep within the heart a Jewish soul stirs, and forward to the ends of the east, an eye looks out toward Zion. Our hope is not yet lost. The hope of 2,000 years be a free people in our land, the land of Zion and Jerusalem.
And we'll listen to it at the end of, I'm going to do a little lecture now on Zionism, the political movement of Zionism. But what I love about this, the anthem is how it brings together, it brings that 2,000-year-old yearning into what was essentially, as we're going to talk about, a very modern secular movement. And that in Israel, you have that. You have this, you know, even the most secular Israelis who don't believe in any God still feel somehow that connection to that yearning of 2,000 years, even if it's not religious, or they feel a connection to the land on some deep way. I mean, it's very interesting how it all comes together. And by the way, when Israel was considering which anthem to make its own, they considered that psalm that we just read, but they didn't want it to be only religious. They didn't want it to be the return to land was just a fulfillment of religious dreams. They wanted something new and fresh. And so they picked these words that were not only an old prayer, but there were something new. I think that's so important, as we'll see in the story of the modern Zionist movement. So now let's talk a little bit about Zionism, right? Because, right, obviously, as we've been talking about, we've been yearning for that land for so very long. I see something in the chat. We believe in one God and we are one family. Oh, that was from before. Thank you, Ruby. So, you know, obviously our yearning for Israel is thousands of years old, and it became very spiritualized because it was not brought into actuality. And so it actually brought our yearning into leading to the establishment of an actual state was a movement in the second half of the 19th century, this modern Zionist movement. And this was a very disworldly movement that existed within the context, right, within Europe of that time, as other forms of nationalism were also starting to be awoken, right? So the Jews of that time looked and they said, well, you know, the Greeks are asking for a state in Greece, and the Italians want a state in Rome, the place of their ancient civilization. So why can't us Jews have a home in our ancient homeland? Doesn't that make sense for us? And modern Zionism is very much born out of some of the conditions that the Jewish people were in at that time. So right in the 1700s, as the whole of Europe went through an enlightenment, the Jewish people changed, because before then Jews were constrained to little ghettos throughout Europe. And Jews didn't have a choice but to be Jewish, because the people at the time said, you're Jewish and you dress a certain way, you speak a certain way, and we're not going to allow you to be part of our society. But then with emancipation, Jews were given rights and were allowed to assimilate for the first time. And many Jews decided to assimilate and, you know, become part of the intellectual movements of Europe at that time. And they were some of the leaders, right? Spinoza and other intellectuals were leading the Enlightenment in Europe. And at the same time, there was this decline of religious authority, which is why Zionism is so secular. But right before then, if you had to live among other Jews, the rabbis were the ones in charge, right? The rabbis, because everything was religious, you know, they were authority of the Jewish communities. And if you, you know, Spinoza, he got on the bad side of the rabbis, so the rabbis excommunicated him, and he wasn't allowed to live in Jewish communities. But he was living at the beginning of a time when Jews were able to live outside of Jewish communities without harm coming to them. So he was able to do that, but before they weren't. I can say rabbis have never recovered since then from our loss of our complete authority. But as the Jews were also engaging in the political life of Europe, there was also another sense, which was, you know, Jews were able now to look the same as everyone else. They were able to speak the same as everyone else. You wouldn't be able to tell a Jew from another, you know, person walking through the cosmopolitan cities of Vienna or Paris or Germany. But anti-Semitism was becoming even worse. And anti-Semitism was taking a different turn. It was saying, well, you know what, Jews are not just a religion, but Jews are a race. And no matter, even if they look the same as us, we're not going to accept them because they're of a different people, a lower people than us. And we're going to keep track of who they are. Even if they try and look the same as us, we're not going to allow them to assimilate to that point. And there was this rise in anti-Semitism and pogroms in East Europe, which was less enlightened. There was more the old form of anti-Semitism. It was very religious. And as you know, the old Russian Empire had, the anti-Semitism was whipped up because Jews who'd moved to Poland and Eastern Europe were doing well for themselves and a lot of discontent. And they were big, they were formed 10% of those areas, if not more. And a lot of discontent was whipped up against them. And Jews were experiencing horrible persecution. And, you know, there would be a period of flourishing, which would last, you know, 50 years, 100 years. And then another period where, you know, 10% of the population would be viciously murdered. And people were just, there's a sense of, are we ever going to get away from this horrible cycle? And the Jews who were being assimilated, you know, said, well, there's nothing more I can do to be part of you. And when is this ever going to end? And that was some of the sentiment which led to Theodor Herzl, who's the father of the modern movement. So right here we have the timeline. Moses Hess writes Rome and Jerusalem, right? Jerusalem is like Rome. We should be allowed to return to Jerusalem just like Italians returned to Rome. Some Jews were following anti-Semitism in Eastern Europe. They were deciding to go to the land and actually follow that that urge. But it's really in the late 1800s when Theodor Herzl, who was one of those really assimilated Jews. And Theodor Herzl was born in the Austrian-Hungarian Empire in Budapest, but then he moved to Vienna, a very Germanic family of high, you know, culture who loved German literature and arts. And he saw the anti-Semitism and he became obsessed with it. But his first response was, you know, all the Jews should convert to Christianity and that will solve the problem. And he had this wild plot to go to the Pope in Rome and convince the Pope, you know, to fight against anti-Semitism if all the Jews will convert to Christianity. Right, what a plot. This is Herzl. But then Herzl, who became, you know, he got his dream job to be a journalist in Paris. And, you know, Paris at that time was the most liberated place in the world. I mean, the most emancipated and progressive. And then the Dreyfus affair in 1894 happened when Dreyfus was an officer, a French officer, high officer in the army, and he was accused of treason. And half of France believed that people were just blaming him because he was a Jew, and the other half were said that he had betrayed France as a Jew. And there were whores in the streets of France running and calling for the blood of Jews. And it was just horrendous. And Herzl witnessing that and also witnessing the mayor of Vienna back in his native Vienna, another very progressive city, who was a virulent anti-Semite. And Herzl lost all hope that even the most assimilated, even Jews who'd converted to Christianity would be allowed to be free. And he became convinced that the only way for Jews to be able to live in safety and security, and he had this terrible premonition that something horrible was going to happen to the Jews of Europe. He was just watching this, you know, this race-based anti-Semitism just being whipped up throughout Europe. And he thought something's going to happen. We have to save the Jews of Europe. And so single-handedly, he was a genius, a dreamy genius. He just went convincing European leaders of his legitimacy as speaking for the Jewish people, and convinced them of, just building up this movement towards creating a land for the Jews. And he wanted the Jews to go back to Israel, but he wasn't totally attached to Israel, right? Here in 1903, he proposed the Jews go to Uganda instead. And when the rest of the Zionist Congress, because he built a whole movement around him in Europe among all the Jews there who, as him, saw the need for it, he thought we should just go to Uganda because there's a better chance. We're being offered it by the British. But the Jews, the others, turned it down, and he thought we've lost our chance forever of having Israel, because he was a pragmatist. He was attached to Israel, but he wasn't a religious person, and he was like, whatever, we have a land, that's enough. But there were other Jews who really felt we needed to return to the land of Israel. And when Herzl wrote, he wrote Der Judenstaat, which was his major Zionist pamphlet about the need for Jews to have his land, but he wrote another book called The Alte Neuland, The Old New Land, which in many ways has a lot of the features of Israel and of the dream of Israel. You know, he imagined a land in the Middle East, in Alte Neuland, that would kind of bring together the power of the Middle East with some of the features of refined Europe. You know, he thought there'd be, you know, beautiful infrastructure, and they would make the desert bloom as they did, and, you know, have all these wonderful scientific advances in universities and highbrow intellectual life, which they did because so many intellectuals moved from Europe to Israel. But he also imagined that the spoken language would be German, and people would be speaking German, and there'd be no troubles with the Arab neighbors, and there would just be this little oasis of peace and modernity in the land. And he basically got half of it. But at the same time, as he had his vision of what it would look like, there were Jews moving in the hordes in these different movements called the Aliyot. An Aliyah is an ascension to Israel. And there were many different types of Zionism. So, for example, in 1882, Pinsker, who was a Jewish leader, he wrote a pamphlet called Auto-Emancipation. He says, Jews have to do it by their own self. We can't rely on other leaders, right? Herzl was going around to the nobles around, the Jewish nobles, to convince them to put money into it, and then going to the political leaders of Europe to grant us access to the land. But others were saying, no, we have to fight for it. And there was this other thing of another sense of transforming the Jewish people. Pinsker said that the Jews, after 2,000 years of exile, were like ghosts, were non-existent, were nebulous, were haunted and haunting and roaming. We have no physical substance. This is a Jew saying this because of our disconnection to land. So what we have to do is build up our sense of strength, build up our sense of something new, and let go of the old. And there was this very strong sense, right, just among the nationalism of the time, we're people without a land, so we've become weak. Berdichevsky was another leader at the time. He wrote, you know, we have to stop being Jews and we have to become Hebrews. We have to be connected to the land. He saw this need to shifting from being bookish to physical labor, from being traditionally religious to secular, from the diaspora to Zion, from praying all the time to tilling the soil, and to being rerooting ourselves in the land. There was this ideology, right? This is the time of ideologies. There was this ideology which was mixing in also with socialism. A lot of the first pioneers who moved to Israel were secular, and they went and they just made their religion the workings of the land. They worked the land religiously. It became their religion, and they didn't observe Shabbat. You know, when they formed the first kibbutzim, a kibbutz was the name for those first settlements of the land. They didn't observe Shabbat. They didn't observe Jewish holidays in the same way. They almost worshipped the socialist leaders more than they worshipped the Jewish religion. But at the same time, there was this connection to the land. And there were poems written about it, beautiful poems. I'm thinking of A.D. Gordon, who speaks of rising early to till the land like laying tefillin was for his parents and grandparents, right? The working of the land, the rhythms of it, was something that was replaced the religion of exile. They saw the Jew of exile had become weak and over-intellectualized and had to reconnect to land. And then you had, anybody have any questions? Or so then you have other forms of Zionism. You have Echad Am, who said, no, you know, we don't need our own state. What we need is a spiritual center for Jews, almost like the Vatican, where Jews can go on pilgrimage, a Merkaz Ruchani, a spiritual center, where we can go and pray and feel connected to. But the pogroms of the late 1800s and 1900s that killed literally hundreds of thousands of Eastern Europe led to a very strong need that, yes, there was a need for an actual state where Jews had autonomy to live out their own lives, because it was not, there was no hope for the Jews of Europe. And on the other hand, there was also a Jewish component. There were Jews who'd been there since the 1800s in the Hasidim in Israel. They were living in the land of Israel, and more religious Jews moved there. And some of those religious Jews didn't know what to do with these secular pioneers who were working the land. But others felt very connected to it. So Rabbi Abraham Cook, Rav Cook as he's known, K-O-O-K, who was one of the first, one of the most important religious leaders of early Palestine, right, just before it became the state of Israel. He was the first chief rabbi, an incredibly spiritual and mystical man. And what he believed was that the return to the land of Israel first had to be done with a body, and then you could have a spiritual return. And so he actually considered Herzl to be the first level of the Messiah, because there had been this tradition that there had been two Messiahs. There would be a Messiah, son of Joseph, and a Messiah, son of David. And the Messiah, son of Joseph, would be the body, the physical part of the return, and the Messiah, son of David, would be the spiritual return. So Abraham Cook would go and dance with the kibbutzniks and the pioneers, because he felt a sense that they were doing the work that needed to be done for the Jewish soul to be restored. And he said, first, the Jewish body has to be brought to wholeness and health, and then the Jewish soul can be returned. And so he saw in that movement the realization of the old prophecies. And he just, he's the father of religious Zionism. And he just was entranced by the power, the power of the Jews. And you know, when you look at the picture of these early, of the Israelis, right, they're strong and vital and, you know, and sexy, and you know, they're like there is a sense of the return to Israel taking on physical characteristic. And there was the darker side of that, right? You have people like Nordau, Max, who, and Jabotinsky. Nordau said Jews have to become muscular and violent. You know, we have to actually become like, we have to become strong, because there's no way to win what we've got to win except by force. So at the same time as all this is happening, right, we're living in our own little world, our story of return. But hey, there are people who are already living on the land of Israel, and those are the Arab inhabitants, Christians and Muslims, a lot of Christians less so this day, who'd been living there for, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years. And, you know, they were seeing this phenomenon of more and more Jews coming into the land. And in 1917, at the end of the First World War, the British, who were controlling the land, who were about to take control of the land from the Ottomans, wrote the Balfour Declaration, which said that they believe the Jews should have a right to their own land on their ancestral land. Why did the British grant this? Some people say they were trying to get the Americans to join the First World War, and they thought that, you know, Jews who were prominent in America would help make that happen. And so the Jews were, you know, they thought now we're going to see the realization of a Jewish state. But after the First World War, when the British took control of that part of the world, became the mandate, the British quickly went back, and they saw how complicated it was, and that, and the Arabs too, when they saw all the Jews moving there, and they also saw the nationalism of the Jews, that gave birth to a nationalism among the Arabs as well. There'd been Arabs living there since the 1800s, calling themselves Palestinians, but they really saw themselves as part of a bigger area, part of the Syrian and kind of Lebanese, but mainly Syrian grouping. And they didn't have a specific to what we now call Palestine identity, but in response to the Zionism of the Jews, they met together. A lot of those lands were owned by absentee landowners who lived in beautiful Damascus, and you know, farmers were toiling the land, but the Jews were buying up the land, and they started to create a national movement. And in the 20s, 1920s and 30s, as more and more Jews came in and started to organize, there started to be more and more clashes between Jews and Arabs. And the first, right, in the 1920s, there were, you know, 60,000 Jews, but then there were 100,000 and 200,000. There were more and more Jews who were building up their presence. And it led to clashes between Arabs and Jews. And in the 1930s, late 1920s, there were massacres. In the 30s, in Hebron, there was a massacre where Jews were massacred by Arabs, right? Hebron was an area that was predominantly Arab, but was the site of the Machpelah, of the place where Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Rebekah and Jacob and Leah were buried. Anyway, a site of Jewish of continual Jewish living for thousands of years. And anyway, there were massacres, and the Jews were organizing in the Haganah, an underground army, to start to build up the military strength to declare independence. And the Brits were just annoyed of both the Arabs and the Jews. And the Brits declared, you know, the Jews and the Arabs will never live together. Their cultures are incompatible, and they each have this strong connection to land. And and there were acts of terrorism by the Jews and massacres by the Arabs against the British. And the British just wanted to leave at a certain point. They had enough of trying to police the land. As Jews, there was this ferment of nationalistic activity and also of underground activity among the Haganah and the Irgun. The Irgun was more set on violence. The Haganah was more waiting to create of the state. At the same time, the British were taking stronger and stronger positions against Jewish immigration. And even during the war itself, the Second World War, when you know there were the rumors and then more and more confirmation of what was happening to Jews of Europe, the British did not open up for the Jews to come in. And that led to the Haganah taking more and more drastic activities against the British and trying to bring in immigrants from Europe on those ships. Hence the story, this is now after the war, but of the Exodus, great book and great movie, and of all of this. So I'm going to talk a little bit more just to finish that history, and then we'll pause for a few questions, and then we'll talk a little bit more about the modern state once it was created. But you know, through the war, there was a lot of activity. I mean, a lot of Jews fought on the side of the British. And then after the war, as more and more images of what happened in the Holocaust came forth and the whole world was shocked by the Holocaust, finally in 1947, in November, the UN, the newly formed UN, came together and voted on the partition of Israel into two states, one for the Jews and one for the Arabs. The Jews were going to get about 55% of the land. Jerusalem and Bethlehem would have been international cities, but there would have been lots of Arabs living in the Jewish lands. The Zionists were very happy. They accepted the partition. You know, we have a state. There were some among them who were opposed, and David Ben-Gurion, who was a leader of the Zionists, he said, you know, any state is better than no state, and we want to go down in history as having accepted the partition. So the Jews accepted the partition, but it was completely opposed and rejected by the Arabs and by the states surrounding them. There was the beginnings of a war, which really only took on full expression after Israel declared its independence in May of 1948. And they were attacked by all the surrounding nations. You know, five nations attacked Israel. Israel was vastly outnumbered in troops and weaponry, but the fervor of wanting to create your own state was enough to give the Jews victory against those overwhelming odds. And to go back to that moment before, right, there was this incredible moment of declaring the first Jewish state in 2000 years. And then there was a war that happened afterwards, where some of the survivors from the Holocaust and the Jews who've been there came together and fought. And there's such incredible stories around it. I should have gone to this before. I want to go back to that moment, because that moment brings to full circle what we've been talking about from the beginning. In 1948, when the state was declared, and it's declared in this hall in Tel Aviv that used to be a museum, right, the small little hall, because they wanted to keep it somewhat secret, because they didn't want it to be attacked, because you know the Arab nations were just waiting for Israel to declare the state to attack. So they wanted to be safe, but the news got out and the streets were throng. And David Ben-Gurion declared the state. You know, our synagogue was in Israel a few years ago, and we went back to that hall, which is now a museum, and we listened to that declaration. And there was not, everybody was teary-eyed, because there's such power in that moment. David Ben-Gurion, in a shaky voice, speaking Hebrew, right? Hebrew that's been revived after 2,000 years of only being used for religious reasons, but throughout the 1900s, Ben Yehuda is the one who's credited with it, but there are others. But you know, people started reviving the Hebrew language, you know, just speaking in their own families, forcing their children to speak this ancient language, and then others speaking it, and then others, and the amount of effort and energy that went into it, and having to invent new words for words that never existed in the Bible, and borrowing words from other languages, and just this incredible thing of reviving that language. So here's David Ben-Gurion speaking Hebrew, you know, and saying, declaring the first Jewish state in 2,000 years, all those years of yearning, and then saying the Shechianu prayer, a prayer of newness, just such power to that. There's a story, I can't remember if it's actually fictional or not, I don't think it matters, of that night of a boy who was the son of a Holocaust survivor who was living in Jerusalem on that night. Actually not the night of 40, not the independence, but the UN partition. And because, right, the whole world was voting on whether to accept partition. And in the story, this boy is in his bed, and he knows all around him, he can hear radios of people listening to the radio of, you know, the Soviet Union voting this way, yes, you know, and of this country voting this way. He describes the scene as finally the vote comes through and Jews have their state. And his father, who was a man who'd been silent, traumatized by the Holocaust, and he describes hearing his father go out, and he decides to follow his father. And there he sees his father on the streets of Jerusalem, and his father is letting out a primal scream, just screaming through the streets, because that was the scream of 2,000 years of Jewish suffering, of 2,000 years of Jewish persecution, of yearning, and finally that moment coming to bear. And that story is so powerful for me, because I think it embodies what those moments were about, 48 and 47, the UN partition, the creation of the state. And it happened in this way, right? This political movement started by Herzl, but it also encompassed so much more. Any thoughts, any comments, any questions? Covered a lot of material. So I think we will just continue then. We're going to read. So we read Hatikva. I'd like to play Hatikva. And then we will read the Declaration of Independence and talk a little bit more about modern Israel. So here's Hatikva, right? Hope. This is really a story of hope. I think this is one of the reasons this story is such a big part of the world story, because it's a story of hope. And here we go. Share a computer sound. So I'm going to rise because I'm Israeli and it's my national anthem, and you can too if you like. The words should be up on the screen. Valeu. So the just beautiful, one of my favorite anthems. One of the aspects that's I think was so powerful about Israel, right? That's a French Algerian Jew who's singing the national anthem of Israel. And a big component of this story has been the fulfillment, so to speak, of prophecies, right? Jews from all over the world going to the land of Israel. So the first waves were very European. They were from Eastern Europe. But right after the declaration of Israel's independence and those decades afterwards, Jews from across the Muslim world came to France. Jews from Algeria, Jews from Iraq, Jews from Morocco. And since then, there have been more and more waves. There was a wave of Ethiopian Jews, right, in the 90s, and a million Russians came in the 90s as well. With Israel being created, the longing that was evoked throughout the Jewish world, a lot of them moved because of they had to, right? In the Muslim world, they were expelled from Muslim countries. And we have members of our congregation, one who was expelled from Egypt, and she wasn't allowed to take anything with her. Her family was been there for generations and generations, and they were expelled from Egypt, and they had to put diamonds in their hair and whatever they could find to take some of what they had with them. They had to leave their homes and their everything they had, not only did it bring Jews from all over the world. It's not easy to integrate people who have such different cultures in Israel, and it took decades. The Jews from Muslim countries, Sephardic Jews originally, were very critical of the Ashkenazi leaders and thought them to be very elitist. I mean, they still do. But I think now in our days, after all these decades, the culture of those Jews is actually probably dominant in Israel. There are more Jews of Arab origin in Israel than there are Jews of European Jew origin in Israel. And their culture and music and so many areas is becoming dominant, and food, definitely. I mean, I personally think that was a good choice to go for falafel and Israeli salad and pita over, blintzes and the heavy fare of Eastern Europe. The pronunciation also, the Jews of Sephardic Jews' pronunciation won over, right? In Israel, we pronounce Hebrew the way Sephardic Jews do, not the way European Jews did. Although obviously a lot, Israel is a modern country that struggles, but the startup nation and all the wonderful things coming from Israel, a lot of that comes from the huge influx of very educated people coming from Russia, from Europe, and from Sephardic lands as well. But that's the story of that was there throughout the next stage of Israel's journey. Let's see, do we have time to read the declaration? I think we'll just read parts of it because I would like to talk about a modern Israel as we finish in the next 20 minutes and the story. So this is the Declaration of Independence, what was read on that night in 1948, or that afternoon. Somebody like to read for us, Eretz Yisrael.
Eretz Yisrael was the birthplace of the Jewish people. Here their spiritual, religious, and political identity was shaped. Here they first attained statehood, created cultural values of national and universal significance, and gave to the world the eternal book of books. After being forcibly exiled from their land, the people kept faith with it throughout their diaspora and never ceased to pray and hope for their return to it and for the restoration in it of their political freedom. Impelled by this historic and traditional attachment, Jews strove in every successive generation to reestablish themselves in their ancient homeland. In recent decades, they returned in their masses. Pioneers and defenders, they made the deserts bloom, revived the Hebrew language, built villages and towns, and created a thriving community, controlling its own economy and culture, loving peace, but knowing how to defend itself, bringing the blessings of progress to all the country's inhabitants and aspiring towards independent nationhood. In the year 5657, at the summons of the spiritual father of the Jewish state, Theodore Herzl, the first Zionist Congress convened and proclaimed the right of the Jewish people to national rebirth in its own country. This right was recognized in the Balfour Declaration of November 2, 1917, and reaffirmed in the mandate of the League of Nations, which in particular gave international sanction to the historic connection between the Jewish people and Eretz Yisrael, and to the right of the Jewish people to rebuild its national home. The catastrophe which recently befell the Jewish people, the massacre of millions of Jews in Europe, was another clear demonstration of the urgency of solving the problem of its homelessness by reestablishing in Eretz Yisrael the Jewish state, which would open the gates of the homeland wide to every Jew and confer upon the Jewish people the status of a fully privileged member of the family of nations.
Let's stop for a second, we're just going to read here, the State of Israel. Do you mind reading the state just at the bottom left, the State of Israel?
The State of Israel will be open for Jewish immigration and for the ingathering of the exiles. It will foster the development of the country for the benefit of all its inhabitants. It will be based on freedom, justice, and peace, as envisaged by the prophets of Israel. It will ensure complete equality of social and political rights to all its inhabitants, irrespective of religion, race, or sex. It will guarantee freedom of religion, conscience, language, education, and culture. It will safeguard the holy places of all religions, and it will be faithful to the principles of the Charter of the United Nations.
Thank you. So we see that at the same time as we're telling our story, the story of the Jewish people and our connection to it, there was also enshrined in the declaration the ideals of a democratic nation, all religions and races, everyone being equal. Arabic was made the second official culture language. I think it was, I'm not 100% sure. The holy places of all religion were said to be safeguarded. And so the declaration kind of tried to do both, make this a state of a Jewish people, but also be open and democratic to all of its inhabitants. And here we see it, and placing our trust in the Rock of Israel, right? So the State of Israel, the declaration is signed, and there was a lot of debate about what to put there. Should put the name of God? Should put, what should you put there? So they put the Rock of Israel because it wasn't too religious, but it was a nod to religion, because the Rock of Israel is a traditional phrase for God, but it wasn't using one of God's names. So there this whole interplay between the religion part, the spiritual part, and the reality and the democratic spirit that its founders had. And the founding fathers of Israel really are, like the founding fathers of any religion, of any country. And I think one of the reasons that the United States and Israel have such a strong connection is because they were both countries, relatively new countries, that were founded with these very high ideals. And they had these incredible founding fathers who, for all their troubles, also enshrined very high aspirations and ideals within the nation, which continue to help guide him morally and ethically. That there's a purpose. The countries aren't just there for people to live, but there's a purpose to them, which I think the United States and Israel both share that sense of purpose. Let's see. So we're not going to move forward and do a little bit of a modern history. We're not going to spend too much time on it. Just to take us to where we are today, when any country is formed, I think the early years are always epic, and some people have said that the founding of the State of Israel, the years since, are like a new chapter to the Bible, because they're so epic, especially when you bring the spiritual component to it, right? We call Israel in our prayer for Israel on Shabbat in services, the flowering, the beginning of the flowering of our redemption. That means that we believe on some level that, or many believe, not everyone, that Israel is the beginning of the redemption. What is redemption? The redemption is that time when the whole world will be in peace or harmony. So when you believe that the act, a political event, right, the founding of the state of Israel was an event that has such powerful spiritual consequences, it means that everything after that is larger than life, right? Whatever is happening. And I think that the history, not only because of our bringing that spirit to it, but it also reflected that, that our time in the land has been so powerful. It really has been almost like a new chapter to the Bible. So, right, the early years, Israel was under, you know, in the 50s, beginning of the 60s, Israel was under a lot of threat from the enemies that they beat in the War of Independence, but that were continually threatening it and its borders. Jerusalem was divided. The West was for the Jews. The East had been taken over by the Jordanians, right? The Palestinians never got their state. The Jordanians took, conquered many of the lands that were meant to be for the Palestinians. Jerusalem was a divided city. There were acts of guerrilla warfare over and over, but the Jews were also just very grateful for their land and they were fighting back. And Israel was very much a third world country then, as anybody who went and visited there, you know, there were nothing worked and it was hard to find basic food items and the buses were old and broken down. And, you know, it wasn't that different than going to India or to a place in the third world, but the early generations in the kibbutzim were very important in these years. You know, some of the generations of leaders, next generations of leaders were being born in these rural communities that had these ideals of communal living. What's a kibbutz? It's a place where there's an ideal of communal living, where even the children of first all were brought up together communally, not by their parents, where they lived in halls, right? The children did not sleep at home. They slept in some of the kibbutzim in communal halls, and everyone ate together and they toiled the land and they came together to speak of, you know, really high ethical and moral ideals. It was very socialist. And so that gave birth to incredible leaders who put the state before their own self and who defended the land and were soldiers. And, you know, we're always thinking in the sphere, in the dynamic of Goliath and David, right? So in these early years, the Arab world was Goliath and Israel was David. We were the small, nimble, flexible, underdog who was able to defeat much larger forces. And that culminated in the Six-Day War in 1967, where in 6 days, particularly in the first few hours, the Israeli military was able to defeat all of the air forces of Syria, Jordan, and Egypt combined. To understand modern Israel, we have to understand this journey through its early years, right? In the years before the Six-Day War, all the states surrounding it started to build up their rhetoric against Israel. Crowds in Egypt under Nasser. Nasser was a leader, a general and leader of Egypt who was starting to proclaim an Arab nationalism, an ideal of a trans-Arab state. What was in the way? Israel was in the way, and crowds were chanting death to Israel in the streets of Egypt, and armies were massing on Israel's borders. Before the 67 war, and there was a sense of doom that the experiment of Israel was coming to an end. It only lasted a few decades. The world was not coming to Israel's aid. The world was saying, France said, if you attack them before they attack you, you will lose our support forever. The Jews felt abandoned. And the armies that were amassing seemed impossible to conquer. The months before the 67 war were just, people were digging mass graves around Israel, fearing for their fate. It was just, you know, the political leaders were, whenever when they appeared on screen, seemed to be themselves just burdened by stress. It was really a horrible period for Israel. And, you know, in the diaspora, you know, there'd been all the support for Israel. The diaspora contributed funds to the establishment. And, but there was Jews went around, Israelis went around the Jewish world collecting funds so that Israel could buy weapons to defend themselves. And it was a time of incredible coming together of the Jewish world as well. So then the Six-Day War was suddenly this miraculous victory. You know, in a few days, in a few hours, they defeat all the air forces by a preemptive strike. And then these miraculous victories where they're able to defeat and triple the size of Israel. They tripled the size of Israel in 6 days, took over all the lands of all the lands that the Jordanians had held, which had actually been the lands of the Bible, right? You know, Tel Aviv up until then had been the real capital of the rebirth of Israel, but Tel Aviv was created in the early 1900s in the desert. It didn't have that ancient significance. It was liberated Jerusalem and liberated the lands of the Bible, right? The lands that are now the West Bank, right? Those were the lands where the Bible happened. So, you know, Jews suddenly were in possession of their biblical lands, and they had all the Sinai areas and deserts, and they tripled the size of Israel. And really, until this day, we're living in the aftermath of the Six-Day War, because at that moment, several forces were born. One, that force which thought, you know, God gave us this, right? This war clearly was God on our side, and it means that we have to go and, you know, accept what God has given us and take back the greater Israel, right? The first, and then there was the other side which said, you know, if we do this, we're going to have a never-ending war. So the peace movement came out of that time too. And those who said, you know, we need to be willing to give back land for peace. And also out of that expansion and confidence, the modern, what has led to the startup nation, Israel's a high-tech power, came out of the Six-Day War. You know, a sense of the sophisticated financial and entrepreneurial and economic part of Israel came out of that too, because of the confidence and new territory that Israel gained. So modern Israel in many ways is really where we are now, was born in that 67 war. And it led to a period of great confidence for Israel, where Israel, you know, the Jews who were religious started to go back to the West Bank, right? The ancestral lands where the Bible was, and started to form the beginnings of settlements, because they thought, you know, we just conquered these lands, why not live there? And, you know, they started to create settlements on lands that were Palestinian. And, you know, I understand the reason why they did it. You know, in hindsight, you know, I think if they had done that while forging relationship with the Palestinians who lived there, maybe there would have been a chance not to be in the mess that we're in now, because there would have been a chance for real coexistence. But when they saw the return to the land, those first settlers were blinded by the power of the religious moment. And it was as if the people who were living there didn't exist, and they didn't think of creating relationship with them. And at the same time, there was a sense of loss of legitimacy in the world because of it was not recognized. And just after the war, Israel actually tried to give back the lands, but they were met with the three no's of Khartoum when the Arab League met in Sudan and said they would refuse, even though Israel was offering them some of those lands back in peace, no to negotiations, no to peace. And I forget the last no right now. But the Arab world did not seem interested in peace. So the Israel thought, well, let's continue with the direction that we've been going on. At the same time, you know, in these in this period is the beginnings of the next stage of Palestinian nationalism, because the Palestinians are living under occupation by the Israelis. And at first it was quite peaceful. I mean, Israelis up until the 80s used to go all the time until the into Palestinian villages and towns to shop, to, you know, had friends there. It was very peaceful. And I think the Israelis were ignoring the Palestinian sentiments. But at the same time, there's also the beginning of Palestinian terrorism. And, you know, throughout this, the end of the 60s and the 70s, throughout the world, there was terrorism against against Jews and Israelis, you know, hostage takings in Munich at the Olympics, and Tebbi, then in the 70s. So there were continual fighting at the same time as there being this general state of the Palestinians accepting, you know, not wanting it, but not fighting against the occupation by Israel. And this goes all the way to the Yom Kippur War in 73, where there was a sense of loss of innocence to some degree, because right, Israel was surprised on Yom Kippur, and the Arab armies attacked and really came close to defeating Israel. The only reason a lot of historians say that they did not defeat Israel was because they came close, but there was nothing between them and Tel Aviv, but they thought Israel must be hiding somewhere because they couldn't believe Israel would be so easily defeated. So they held back, but they could have actually defeated Israel. And Israel came very close to annihilation. And it created this profound period during the 70s where Israel felt very depressed. You know, they thought we're never going to be, you know, they came close to being destroyed. You know, they almost pressed a button on the nuclear weapons. And, you know, is this ever going to end? The Arab countries came together to organize a boycott of Israel. Israel had had relationships with many African and developing countries to, you know, help them in agriculture and just had, but the Arab countries forced a boycott of Israel. Israel, you know, the UN declared Zionism was racism, and there was a sense of Israel being all alone. And it coincided with the growth of the right wing, because, you know, the right wing in Israel said, if the world's going to hate us, everybody's going to hate us, we're just going to go and do our thing. Many Israelis started to believe more and more in the dream of greater Israel. You know, if the world is not going to accept us, we might as well, you know, fulfill our fate. Then in the 80s, there was the Lebanon War, where Israel, first there was the peace of Egypt, which was this wonderful moment where Menachem Begin made peace with Egypt. There was a cold peace, but they made peace. And then in the 80s, Israel, another further loss of innocence, according to some, where Israel got involved in Lebanon too deeply and ended up getting burnt when its Christian allies in Lebanon committed massacres in Sabra and Shatila. And that created some of the biggest demonstrations in Israel ever, because of Israel being allied, and nobody quite knows how guilty they were in those massacres. But eventually, Israel was entrenched in Lebanon. Israel was now no longer the David, but becoming the Goliath. Maybe not in intention, but just in being such a powerful military nation. But at the same time, we have this, you know, the return of the, the nations. You know, there'd been a community of Ethiopian Jews for 2,000 years plus, and they were airlifted in the 80s in Operation Moses and Solomon to bring these Ethiopians to Israel, which was just another incredible, right, the moment where everybody was feeling depressed about the state of Israel. Such moments just lifted everybody up and reminded them of, you know, what Israel was about and what was happening. And then you get to the last stage of our history, you know, the beginning of the first Intifada in the late 80s. And this is where there was finally the Palestinians national movement coalesced in this uprising against Israelis. My family was living there at the time. We lived in the edges of a refugee camp where Palestinians were. And I remember there were, you know, helicopters always around, cars in our neighborhood were being firebombed. There were tracer bullets hitting our balcony. I mean, it was a big mess. And I think the way Yossi Klein Halevi, who I love the way he described this, he says that first intifada shattered the mainstream Israel's belief in the greater Israel, because they saw that the Palestinians would not accept Israel's rule, and they too had national aspirations. And so a whole huge mainstream of Israel turned to the left in these years, and that led to the election of Rabin and the peace accords, where Israel accepted land for peace. We are going to give away the land that we feel we conquered, that's ours, in return for peace. Now, I'm going to give the Israeli narrative. There's also a Palestinian narrative, but the Israeli narrative is that throughout the 90s, Israel, in spirit and indeed, worked towards peace. Peace was taught in our schools. Israelis went to, Palestinian cities to learn to go to jazz clubs. Israelis were fully on board with peace, but this is the Israeli narrative. The Palestinians behind the scenes were actually creating factories where they were creating weapons, where they were creating plans to use the peace to actually attack Israel. And that, those fears materialized when recordings of Arafat, who was their leader, in a mosque in South Africa, speaking to, and was not supposed to be recorded, a speech where he said, we're just building up peace so we can then attack them from a place of greater strength. And there were more and more terrorist attacks from those parts of the Palestinian coalition from Hamas who were completely opposed to peace in any form. It's hard to know exactly what was in Arafat and the Palestinian authorities' mind, but it's true that they were building up a military strength. And then eventually there was also big opposition among Israel, because what was the peace? Essentially giving away the lands of the Bible in return to peace. And the many of the religious Zionists were completely opposed to this idea. And eventually it's a religious Zionist who kills Yitzhak Rabin in 95, who assassinates him, believing that Yitzhak Rabin is, giving away what God had given to us. After that, this creates even more coalition behind from Israelis for peace. And Israel offers in the late 90s, twice, more than 95% of all of what the Palestinians were asking for. They said, let's just go to a final agreement. Let's just give over 95% of all the lands what you're asking for, and let's just make it happen. We're there. And the Israeli narrative is that, the Jews had worked up to that moment, but the Palestinians had not. They'd continued to preach hate, and that all of Israel belonged to the Palestinians. The Palestinian narrative is that the Jews had not gone quick enough. They'd still been maintaining checkpoints, had not gone far enough in granting authority and land in autonomy to the Palestinians. And eventually it led to another Palestinian uprising where in the Palestinian narrative, as they say, well, they were just fed up that Israel wasn't going fast enough. The Israeli narrative is that the Palestinians had planned all along to attack the Jews from a place of greater strength. And suddenly, they'd given autonomy to the Palestinians. They were just a mile away from Jerusalem or 2 miles away from here. And suddenly in the early 2000s, there's Palestinian suicide bombers blowing themselves up every day on the streets of Jerusalem throughout the land of Israel. And, they'd been building up capabilities. So suddenly they have guns and they have weapons. In the first uprising, they'd only had sticks and rocks. And Israel was rocked. It was one of the darkest moments in Israel's history. I remember living there at the time, and buses are exploding. You never knew who was going to be on that bus. Israel fought back very strongly and, decided and destroyed some of the buildings, the early buildings of statehood that the Palestinians had made. The military, there was one moment at the beginning of the Intifada where two Israeli soldiers got lost and waylaid and ended up in a Palestinian town, and they were lynched by the Palestinians. Their limbs were torn off. They were, blood was, and when Israelis saw that, they saw this is civilians. This is not, this is civilians who are doing that, holding up their hands of blood on them. And to Israelis, that was a sense of the complete loss of belief that there was a partner for peace. And you know, I can't speak fully for the Palestinian point of view, but there were 3,000 dead. There were 3,000 dead on the Israeli side, and countless on the Palestinian side, and it led to the Israelis Israel lost total faith in the left. All of Israeli politics went from the left completely to the right, because they said, you know, first they'd gone, the dream for greater Israel failed, and then the dream for peace failed. So Israelis became very jaded, very pragmatic, and, you know, we're in theory interested in peace, but only if we have a real partner for peace. That became the Israeli mainstream. Eventually Israel built a wall to stop the Palestinian suicide bombers from being able to enter the country, and it worked. Suicide bombing stopped. The wall is not pretty, and the wall was not perfect, but most Israelis said the wall, you know, saved us from, daily suicide bombings, because now there's a wall between us and the people who are willing to kill themselves to kill us. And it created a lot of hardship for the Palestinians, which is awful. And then, you know, I will say is, you know, throughout all of this, the Palestinian people suffered more than the Jewish people. And that's a fact, because their conditions were always worse. And the Palestinians suffered more from all of this than the Jews did. And then, you know, the Israeli side of it is, you know, in the, you know, Ariel Sharon, who was one of the early generals, one of the founding fathers, who was known for being a very strong military leader, he, the one who came in and decided to try peace again in the early 2000s. And he's the one who decided to withdraw from Gaza. But then what happened when they withdrew from Gaza? Eventually Hamas, you know, a terrorist organization, took control of Gaza, and rockets started to rain down on Israel. So the Israeli narrative was, you know, is this what we get for land for peace? And Israelis became further jaded and further not believing in peace. And you know, the Israel had been occupiers for a long time, and I totally understand the Palestinians. I mean, Israel's occupation of those lands became more and more militarized because of the uprising, became more and more of a stranglehold on the Palestinians, and the Palestinians, what their reaction was to fight back with more and more strength, and it became an intractable position where it's kind of like you're trying to hold down a tiger, you know, with your bare hands. And, you know, the moment you let go, the tiger is going to attack you, but what can you do? So it's just been, since then, it's basically been getting, it's been worse and worse. And the tensions for Israelis has been really getting to Israel. And, you know, the tensions between the religious has been growing. The ultra-Orthodox community has been growing more and more and trying to impose their ultra-Orthodox way of life on the rest of the country. You know, people always try and map out, you know, American ways of looking at, you know, American ways of looking at race and all these ideas into Israel, but they don't work in Israel, whatever. It's different context. In Israel, those who are the most opposed to Palestinian statehood and who are the most opposed to the the ones who walk in the streets of Israel saying death to Arabs, for the most part, those are Sephardic Jews, Jews of color, because they're the ones, they say, we're the ones who lived under you know, Muslim rule, and we know what they're capable of, you know. And the very left wing are the Ashkenazis, you know. So it's a completely different idea and organization. And, you know, the tension in Israel has been really bad since the Second Intifada for the last 20 years. And, you know, it's led to a lot of digging in, you know, on both sides. On the other hand, there's also a lot of, and I'd like to end here, there's a lot of, you know, you read in the news about all the difficulties, but there's incredible grassroots activity among Israelis and Palestinians to get to know each other. And we'll hear more and more. We have a plan later in the summer to bring a friend who's been doing some of this work. And, you know, there's a lot of positivity. And Israelis, despite all of this, are still, when they're polled, among the 10 happiest countries in the world, who are just overjoyed at the blessing of living in a dream, the dream of Israel, the dream of the return to the land, a country where everybody, a small country where everybody is your brother and sister. Israeli Arabs are who are Muslim and Christian, are have more and more of a voice and rights within the country. It is an amazing country, right? The country that's vaccinated the most of its people of any kind, the fastest of any country in the world, at the same time as it experienced more waves of the virus than the other because of its dysfunctional politics. A country that leads the world in startup and innovation, but they can't figure out how to vote in the government. So there is, it's still a holy balagan. Balagan is an Israeli word for mess. So it's a holy mess. But still, what I love about it is the sense of vitality, the sense of power that you're living in a dream, that you're living in this incredible moment. And so I'd like to end with a video of this Israeli phenomenon, which is called Kululam. Israel is a very, Israel is, you're hearing my son in the background. Israel is a wonderful place where everybody knows each other and people love to gather and experience and process everything they go through together. So a few years ago, they started to come together to sing with this project called Kululam, where 3,000 people come together, learn the song, and then sing it together, and they're filmed. So I'm going to play you a video of one of these. This is a song called Al Kol Eile, which is about the love of land from the early days of Israel, that epic time of connection to the kibbutzim. And this is sung a few years ago for Israeli Independence Day. And I think it captures some of that spirit you can see in the faces of the crowd, that love of their country, that hope, that dreams fulfilled, and that sense of no matter how difficult it is, we will continue to believe in this project. And, you know, Bizrat Hashem, there'll be peace and there'll be harmony and people will be able to live and we'll figure out all of the difficulties. So here we go. Oh, Very moving, right? So any questions or thoughts? I think we'll end here. Nice to see everyone.
Thank you. A lot to absorb.
Nice to see everyone. Bye, Maggie. Bye, Yochanan. Susan, Charles.
Bye.
Good day. Thank you.